because of the wine. That's the great thing about having your meetings in Italy, right? You have Prosecco. So I have, you'll see I have pictures of elephants up here. And that's because we have a saying in English, the elephant in the room. And that really means like there's something that nobody's really talking about, but everybody knows it's there. And so I think the elephant in the room for repositories and for us and our vision of repositories as being the foundation of a new scholarly communication system is that we are collecting research articles that are being published elsewhere. And really, how can that change the system? So this next session, we're going to talk about a new vision for repositories that puts them in a more central position and potentially might help us actually change the system to the kind of community-based distributed system that we're talking about. And we're calling that that work that we're doing around defining this vision and developing new architecture, conceptual models, and technologies for repositories and repository networks, next generation repositories. So I think Eloy is going to talk about what we've been doing so far, and so I'd like to turn it over first to Eloy, but I think this is something from the core perspective that we're very excited about and we think has a lot of promise in terms of helping us really step up our game in the repository world and, you know, saying goodbye to the elephant in the room. So let me invite Eloy Rodriguez, core chairman, to come and talk.
Thank you, Stephanie. Can I get my slide? So this session is really about making our vision and the vision of CORE a reality. As many of you know, we have launched this initiative a year ago, exactly on the annual meeting in Vienna. And we have been doing some work, and we thought that as this is really one fundamental piece of work and the strategic direction of CORE, that we should present it, the results so far on this annual meeting today. So we will have a session. I will go very briefly. I don't want to take the time because also we are already starting 10 minutes late. We will have the session organized in two parts. Apart from this 5 to 10 minutes introduction that I will do now, we will have some examples of the work of the first part of the work that we have done. We have identified user stories, and some of them of those user stories will be presented by Paolo Mangi, by Peter Moth, and by Pandelis Bracakis. Then we will break for a short coffee. And then on the second part, we will try to discuss how to get from here to there. So what are the implications for repository platforms, how new repositories should look like or should look like, and how we can get from here to there. And this, and we will try to close the session with opening the floor for a collective discussion on how to proceed in advance. Just to remember again that the working group was launched in April 2016 during our annual meeting in Vienna, because again we are, and I think this feeling is not just a core feeling, it's just the feeling of the people working on CORE. We have seen this expressed or written in several places, that repositories have not really fully realized their potential. And they are in many cases working just as they are. There are two main problems. One, they are silent. They are kind of isolated, or even when they are isolated, they are not completely interoperable, they are not completely from the web, they are using still kind of old technologies. And the second thing is that repositories are kind of passive recipients of content that in many cases is produced elsewhere, for instance, the publications that are published elsewhere, and then the final version of that publication is finally deposited on the repository, and so the repository is a passive recipient of that content. And the aim, of course, was to identify the functionalities and the architecture for this new generation of repositories. With this vision, and again I refer to what Catherine just said, and I was really pleased this morning with the session and discussion, and I see that also this vision resonates very well with what we have heard from the Future of Libraries vision from MIT. So to put repositories, and more than repositories, because I think here the question is not really the information system, it's not repositories, but to put research community and the research institutions in the center and on the steering wheel of the scholarly communication system, again, because that's the main objective of developing and reshaping the scholarly communication system in a way that is more research-centric, that is more close to the needs of our communities, and it is also more innovative, more open, and also a very important point that is also collectively managed by the research community. And this, I think it's always important that we have been, for instance, we have a meeting of the community during the lunch, and again, the question of this vision again rises up, and it's important when we start discussing some technical issues that this vision pops up again and remember why we are doing what we want to do and why we are doing this. So the objective that we have identified a year ago was again to improve the repository interoperability by exposing uniform behaviors across repositories and also to integrate repositories with global scholarly infrastructures and to foster or to encourage the emergence of added value services that can use those uniform behaviors to support the different functions like discovery, access, annotating, sharing, content transfer, etc. So we have a very good working group. So I think the initial working group, we have people coming to the working group during this year, but we have a very good working group, both from different points of view, from geographical location, from the different experiences on also related with both people experience on local repositories and on repository networks, on different software platforms, etc. And this group has been working during this year. Initially, on our first meeting in Vienna, we had identified four areas of priorities. That this was, I think this slide was already shown in Vienna because it was the result of our first meeting. It was discovery, assessment, workflows, and impact. But then when we start to work on these issues, we thought also that it would be very important to establish some principles and some design assumptions. And again, these principles I will not detail very much because I don't want to take much time. But again, these principles are very important and are related to our vision. So the question again of distribution of control. We want a system where no player can really gain a control or a weight on a system that could kind of imbalance this distribution of control. The inclusiveness, so to a system that can account for the diversity of for the regional diversity, for the different stages of development that we have, also for instance on repository networks and then other areas. The public good, again, we are doing a system that is we want to build a system, we want to reshape a scholarly communication system that is driven by public good and it is good for science, not for other reasons. And the question of intelligent openness, so we want a system that is as open as possible, as open as possible. And the design assumptions that we also have expressed, I think it is also important. This one, again, I will not go into the details. That's a very important point. This first one, that we need to move from metadata. Much of the work that we have been doing on repositories and on the technologies that we use are based on moving metadata from one place to another, and we need to probably move away from that and focus more on the resources themselves and not just the metadata. And again, also to have a pragmatic solution, so to have the low cost and using the low hanging fruits that's also for the same reasons that we prefer evolution to revolution and convention over configurations. And again, and that we also need to engage users where they are. So on this here we have decided to go through these tasks. So to identify major use cases, to determine what functionalities and behaviors are needed for these next generation repositories. And we may say that we have already completed these two first tasks, and I will just briefly refer. I think probably you all know that we have published an initial document in February that addresses the use cases. And then we are now when we had a meeting this lunchtime, we are already working on defining the technologies and on developing the conceptual models. And that's the current situation. In February, we published, as I told you, we published a document with the user scenarios, the user stories, and those user stories were 12. I will not go through them. Some of them will be presented now. Three of them will be presenting now after me. But we have identified those two. We have received something should be. There's some text that is missing on this slide. Probably I just deleted. So we have received several, I don't remember how many, around 40 comments, 60, that we have received 60 comments for the document, and we have reviewed those documents, and we have already produced a kind of a revised version of the user stories, of those user stories that we are just now finalizing. And based on that revised version of the user stories, we are now working on developing the conceptual models, on identifying the needed technologies, probably on five of those areas. So probably we will not address, because we don't have the capacity, especially the time, and we are a group of people